Well, after we continued with our review of the MCU last week, this week we're going to step into a good old-fashioned pre-MCU Marvel movie as we review The Punisher, released in 2004. The film, of course, serves as an origin story for the comic book character The Punisher, aka Frank Castle. It was also not the first Punisher movie, the first one being in 1989, and would also not be the last, as there ended up being a remake in 2008, and then later on a TV series on Netflix as well. But for those of you not familiar with The Punisher, basically Frank Castle gets his entire family killed by a mafia boss that he accidentally crossed, and now he's out to get some revenge, and of course, some punishment. The film starred Thomas Jane, who you might also know from Boogie Nights, Deep Blue Sea, and The Mist as the Punisher Frank Castle, and also starred John Travolta, who you might know from a lot of stuff, as the main villain Howard Saint. The film did decent enough at the box office, making about $54.5 million on a budget of $33 million. It is pretty crazy thinking that a Marvel movie only made $54 million, but this is a good few years before the superhero boom, and also just a couple years after the first Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movie. The movie did kinda wishy-washy with critics, but a lot of people who actually saw it ended up liking it, and it's aged pretty well, with audiences kind of turning into a cult classic, especially considering they ended up doing a remake in 2008, or maybe just kind of a reboot, not so much a remake, I don't think it was a complete origins film, but they were supposed to do a sequel to this, a direct sequel, it got cancelled and they instead did a reboot, and people really didn't like that reboot, so this looked better as a result. And I gotta say, personally, I really liked it a lot. It was kind of corny at some points. At some points it was. It's a very dark movie. Like, it's an incredibly dark story and a dark movie, and there were some corny parts, but overall, it conveyed the tone pretty well, and the acting by a lot of the characters, including Thomas Jane as Frank Castle, and also Ben Foster as Dave, who I'll get more into a little bit later for his performance, did very well in their roles. And overall, I think it was a very good adaptation of The Punisher. But I guess it's time to find out if Frank Castle got that punishment he was seeking after all, and we're gonna find out right now as we review The Punisher, released in 2004. Now before we begin, I want to convey that I'm using the extended edition for this review. The reason why that's important is because it adds to the runtime by about 15 minutes. The reason it does that is that because it restores a whole subplot, which is kind of important subplot, and for whatever reason it was completely cut from the theatrical release. So we begin our film by meeting mafia boss Howard Saint and his wife Olivia, who own and operate a nightclub which they use to launder their money. We also meet their twin sons, Bobby and John, and Bobby is going on an arms deal with his friend Mickey, unbeknownst to his father. They're making the deal with a man named Otto Krieg, but they're quickly ambushed by the police. And in a scenario that very much embodies the American police, both Bobby and Krieg are very quickly shot to death when they panic and don't drop their guns. So Bobby is actually dead, but turns out Krieg isn't, because Krieg really isn't Krieg. He's actually Frank Castle, an undercover FBI agent who's about to retire. And after the mission is complete, his best friend and partner agent James Weeks throws him a surprise party and also gives him a watch. Meanwhile, Howard's pretty pissed that his son is dead, and he instructs his right-hand man and best friend Quentin to beat the shit out of Mickey. He spares Mickey's life, but kills Bobby's personal bodyguard as a result of this. Meanwhile, Frank is returned home to his wife Maria and his son Will, and they're planning on moving one more time out of Tampa Bay to London. Saint meanwhile meets up with the Toro brothers, who run a casino, and also help Saint launder his money. Turns out Agent Weeks gambles at this casino, and he has quite a bit of a problem and he's lost a bunch of money. Saint then confronts him over the identity of Otto Krieg, and then Weeks appears to rat Castle out. Going back to Castle, he and his entire family, and I mean his entire family, are in Puerto Rico for one big family reunion. Back in Tampa after burying his son, Saint gets Frank's identity. He orders Frank killed, but turns out his wife Livia is a lot more ruthless than he is, and she orders Frank's entire family killed. And back in Puerto Rico, everybody's just having a good time, enjoying the family reunion. Frank and his dad are talking about guns, and there's Frank's mom, and she's dead, and oh god, here they come. And then Saint's men, led by Quentin and John, proceed to just slaughter Frank's entire family. They end up killing Frank's dad as well, but Maria and Will end up getting away in a truck followed by a truck of the bad guys, followed by Frank on a motorcycle. Eventually, their car gets overturned, they end up on some docks trying to get to a boat, until they're promptly just ran the fuck over by the bad guys. Frank arrives too late and sees his dead family before he's ambushed by the bad guys, and John just proceeds to beat the shit out of him before just shooting him seemingly dead. Quentin then lights the whole dock on fire, and the explosion actually sends Frank into the water. And that ended up being beneficial to him, as he's saved by a local fisherman. The fisherman nurses him back to health, and then Frank goes and collects his dad's guns before heading back to Tampa Bay. Frank then moves into a mostly abandoned apartment building with only three of her tenants, Joan, Dave, and Bumbo. Frank also kidnaps Mickey and tortures him for information, and Mickey, hating the Saint family, gives it up. Mickey reveals that Howard and Livia mostly have a routine and they go to same places on certain days, oh, and also that Quentin is a closeted homosexual. Frank then very quickly lets everybody know that he's still alive by putting his tombstone on the golf course for Howard to find, and also confronting Weeks and the police chief at the police station. He then goes and robs Saint's mob bank, throwing most of the money out the window and taking some of it for himself. The next day, Agent Weeks tries to convince him to get out of town, and he starts to notice something strange about Weeks. For instance, his Porsche is gone, and he's traded it in for a normal car, but I'm sure there's nothing suspicious about that. Back at the apartment building, Joan is being harassed by an abusive ex-boyfriend, who Frank promptly beats the shit out of. Frank then starts to put another part of his plan into motion. Basically, he steals Livia's car and brings it to a hotel. He then blackballs Quentin with the pictures of him kissing another man and tells him to come to the hotel, so Quentin's at the hotel as well, and then Livia's car gets a ticket, and then Frank leaves and takes the car back to where Livia was. All this will make sense a little bit later. So the next day or whatever, Frank is having breakfast at a diner where Joanne works at, and then some man with tattoos comes in with a guitar and sings him a country song. Like, this whole scene is so fucking funny. He literally tries to intimidate him with country music. Turns out the man's actually an assassin named Harry Heck, and he later ambushes Frank near a bridge. Harry overturns Frank's car and he's about to kill him, but Frank uses a ballistic knife to stab him right through the throat, which is a really cool kill. And since his car is destroyed, he decides to take Harry's, because I mean, he's not going to need it. Frank then also later destroys a boat which had a lot of the Toro brothers and Saints' shared money. Turns out it was mainly the Toro brothers' money though, and they are pissed, and this has seriously strained their relationship with Saint. Back at home, Frank is convinced by his roommates to have dinner with them, and they all have kind of a bonding experience. Frank is then attacked by a huge new assassin called the Russian, who was actually played by legendary professional wrestler Kevin Nash. The Russian mainly beats the shit out of Frank until they fight into the room where the others are making stew, and then Frank then throws said stew on the Russian and tackles him down the stairs, which kills the Russian by breaking his neck. Frank is still pretty badly fucked up though, and to make matters worse, Quentin and friends have arrived. They arrive to find just Dave and Bumbo, while Joan and Frank are hidden in an elevator shaft. Quentin threatens Dave, but Dave refuses to give up Frank's location, and this is the acting from Ben Foster I was telling you about. This is probably the best acted scene in the whole movie. Quentin uses some pliers to rip out his piercings, and just the screams of pain and the pure emotion demonstrated by Ben Foster in the scene was incredible. It was incredibly well done, and I give him all the credit in the world for it. Quentin and the others leave, but they also leave a man behind to wait for Frank. Frank recovers pretty quick though, because this is a superhero movie, and he uses a makeshift machete to kill the man outside. Frank then decides it's time to about finish shit off, and he gets to work on doing that. His plan with Livia's car and Quentin, though, is now fully set into motion, as Mickey, who is secretly working for Frank, gives the parking ticket to Howard, who he also told that Quentin was at the hotel before, and the parking ticket was located at the hotel. So then, Howard goes to Quentin's house and finds his wife's earrings in Quentin's bed, and he confronts Quentin and ends up stabbing him to death over it. We'll pick back up with that in a second as we now go to Agent Week's apartment as he arrives home with Frank there waiting for him. Frank reveals that he knows that Weeks set him up because he figured out Weeks has a gambling problem, and then he leaves his gun behind as he stands up. Agent Weeks picks it up and attempts to shoot Frank, who took all the bullets out. Frank then gives him back one bullet and basically forces him to commit suicide. It's probably the darkest scene in the entire movie, and this scene, not just this scene, but this whole plot line, for whatever reason, was cut from the theatrical version. So I guess in the theatrical version, there's just no comeuppance for Weeks. You know, he just doesn't get back at him at all, even though he gave him up. Like, again, it's very, very strange that this was cut. It seems pretty significant to me. Back at the Saint household, things are not going very well, as Howard has blown a fuse thinking that his wife cheated on him, but I'm sure he's gonna react very rationally, right? Nope, he takes her to a bridge and promptly yeets her off it, where she's promptly run over by a fucking train. Howard, as well as his son John, then lock themselves in a nightclub with a bunch of other assassins who are there to kill Frank. Frank then shows up and takes out a couple guys all stealth style with a bow and arrow. He then plants a bomb on the front door and sends some champagne up to everybody up there, which ended up having a bomb in it. The assassins that survive the explosion don't survive for long as Frank kills them. Meanwhile, Howard tries to get out the front door, but luckily somebody runs right in front of him and triggers the explosion. Frank also decides to fuck with John, whose arm has been completely pinned, by having him hold up an explosion, which will explode as soon as he drops it. And as John explodes, Frank finally confronts Howard outside the building, where they have a very quick duel, which obviously Frank wins. Frank then reveals to Saint that his best friend and wife never betrayed him and that he killed them for no reason, before deciding on a unique way to kill him. That unique way is that he ties him to a back of a car, which then goes into a car lot in which all the cars explode and set Saint on fire. And then an overhead shot reveals that all the cars exploded to make the Punisher logo, which is corny as hell, but also just so fucking awesome. Frank then returns to his apartment and with the job done prepares to commit suicide, but after having a vision of his wife, he decides not to go through with it. He says goodbye to Joan and reveals to her that he left them a little something, which ends up being the money that he stole from Saint. The movie ends with a monologue from Frank who promises to kill anyone who harms innocent people and proclaims himself the Punisher. So like I mentioned before, this film was supposed to get a direct sequel with Thomas Jane coming back as Frank Castle. However, both Thomas Jane as well as the director and the writer, John Heisingly, ended up leaving the project due to creative differences with the studio. This actually did not end up being Jane's last performance as the Punisher though, as he came back in a 10-minute short film in 2012 called The Punisher Dirty Laundry. And you know what that means? That means it's time for a motherfucking bonus review! So the film begins with Frank waking up in his van before going to do his laundry. Meanwhile, a street gang ran by a man named Goldtooth confronts some prostitutes, one of which he beats up and takes to a back alley and rapes, while Frank just does nothing about, despite seeing and listening to the whole thing. The gang also jumps a kid named Deshaun after he refuses to sell drugs for them. Frank also does nothing about this, and instead goes to a convenience store across the street. The convenience store is run by a man in a wheelchair named Big Mike, who was played by Ron Perlman, who you might know from a lot of things, including being Hellboy. Mike implies that he previously tried to stand up to the gang, and that is why he's crippled. Despite the fact that he's 6 months sober, Frank buys a bottle of Jack Daniels, which he uses to just fucking murder the fuck out of all these gang members. Like, holy shit, he kills like 5 dudes with a bottle of Jack Daniels. He then fucks Goldfinger up something fierce, breaking both his arms and both his legs. He then pours the Jack Daniels on him and pulls out a lighter, leaving it right in front of him. Frank goes back to get his laundry while the prostitute that Goldfinger raped shows up and lights him on fire. Frank puts his laundry in his car and Deshaun tells him that he dropped a shirt, but Frank tells him to keep it. As Frank speeds off, the shirt is revealed to be of the Punisher logo. And to talk about this short film real quick, oh my god, like that was incredibly well done. The scene where he beats the shit out of all of them is like arguably the best produced live action Punisher media ever made. Like, holy shit, like he killed five dudes with a bottle of Jack Daniels and just broke both the guy's legs. Like, it was crazy. That whole 1 minute scene was insane, and he just looked like an absolute badass. As far as our main film goes, I'm also very sad that Thomas Jane did not get to do his sequel, especially considering maybe if that had gone well, he would have been inserted into the MCU. I haven't seen much of the Punisher Netflix show, so I can't give much of an opinion on that, even though I heard it was good, but I really, really enjoyed this, and I thought he did just such a great job as the role. Again, it was corny at points, and it really is the epitome of, you know, pre-MCU Marvel movies. Like, it wasn't, like, great or blow you out of the water or anything, but I think it's a very, very underrated movie, and it doesn't really get the respect it deserves, and it deserves it. It really does. It's a really good film. So would I recommend this? Absolutely yes. I think this is a great Punisher film. I would not recommend the 2008 reboot Punisher Warzone, however, which is not so good. But if you want to see either of them and you happen to have HBO Max, just as of a couple days ago, they've both been added to there. So, good timing. So you might be thinking, well, Noah, you switch directions on this channel a lot. We've done two straight Marvel movies. Are we going to switch directions again? Oh, you bet your sweet ass we're going to switch directions, as next week we go and review Queen Kong. It's like King Kong, except it's not. Dear God, is it not? But that, ladies and gentlemen, is going to do it for my review of The Punisher 2004, as well as The Punisher Dirty Laundry 2012. Thank you guys for watching. If you liked it, be sure to like it. If you didn't like it, don't. If you want to follow any of my social media links, they're in the description down below. Thank you to all my Patreon for supporting me and my channels. With all that being said, though, my name is Noah Taff. This has been my review of both the Tom Jane Punisher films, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.